Work has been underway for quite some time to prepare for the current Colorado legislative session. What can we expect this year, and how might new laws affect you? State Senator Mike Johnston joins Denver DA Mitch Morrissey to talk about the highlights on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Hello, everyone. I'm Tamara Banks, and welcome back to Dialogue Denver DA. Mitch, great to see you as always.
Good to see you, Tamara.
We have sort of a VIP here today, don't we?
We really do. We have State Senator Michael Johnston. He represents a segment of Denver, and I'm just glad that he could take the time today, because they are in session, to come down and be part of the show.
Great to have you here, Senator.
Delighted
Mike.
To be here.
So you've been serving in the legislature for 7 years, right?
That's right. This is my seventh.
Yeah. So how's that working for you? Having a good time?
Or I am having a good time.
Out yet?
I just had to break it to my kids that I'm term limited out. They came to opening day yesterday and were so excited. And I had to let them know this was their last opening day, and so they were a little bit shocked. But they're the only ones who were shocked. I think it's been a good 6 years, but. I think we've gotten some things done.
So as we're watching this and our viewers are watching this at home, it's already February. So can you talk about what might be different this session versus the past few years that you've been serving?
Sure. You know, I think this session is always a little bit different in even number year because it's an election year. And so you have a lot of people are preparing for elections coming up in November, or they're running for different seats. And so you tend to get a little more stalemate in an election year because people are a little less willing to take risks. And then we also do have a divided government. So we have a Republican-controlled Senate, a Democratic-controlled House, and a Democratic governor. And so it tends to be a little bit more difficult to pass bills from either side in that situation. And so I think what you won't see many big ideological bills passed this year. I think there'll be a couple of the big fight will be about the budget this year and how we solve some of the budget crisis that we're in. And I think you'll see a lot of smaller bills that hopefully have interesting coalitions of liberals and Republicans together that come together to pass some good work.
So tell us about some of your committee assignments. What do you have in store?
So I serve on the Education Committee and on the Finance Committee, and then on the Legal Services Committee. So mostly spend most of my time on education and on finance issues.
And does that impact sort of your goals for the whole session?
You know, most people will tend to legislate in the areas of their expertise, and so most of the bills you do tend to be in those areas of your committees. I was on the Judiciary Committee for a while, and I have a law degree by background, and so I've always been more interested in some of the judiciary issues, and so I'll have a number of bills in that field as well, but I'll do a fair amount of work in education and finance too.
And so for those folks who don't know, you come from, as you said, the educational world of a former teacher and a principal, yeah. And now you're a big-time political leader.
I don't know about big time, but I was a high school principal for 6 years before this here in the Denver area, and then was a teacher before that. So I did have a short stint where I went to law school. My wife, who's an actual district attorney, says that I'm not a real lawyer, but I do have a legal background, and so I've always been interested in some of the criminal justice issues in the state as well.
So speaking about legal issues, let's talk about the misdemeanor DNA, that process, and what is that all about?
You bet. So I've been delighted to work with Mitch on this the last couple of years, but one of the things we found is that there is a real opportunity for crime prevention here, and that we have certain offenders. You look at violent rapists or even murderers or sometimes serial rapists who, you know, the data says that most serial rapists will commit 6 rapes before they ever get caught. And so the question is, do we have the opportunity before that happens to find these folks and identify them before they continue to commit more crimes? And so what we've proposed is currently in Colorado, if you are charged with a felony, when you're charged with a felony, the state takes a DNA sample, and that allows us to see if there are other cold case crimes, other murders or rapes that where we have DNA on file would have never solved that crime, to be able to make that linkage. What we're proposing is in a small number of misdemeanor cases, and those misdemeanors that are target domestic violence, that target solicitation and Johns, and that target child abusers. So really, that we would, in those situations, after someone were convicted of a misdemeanor crime, we would also take a DNA sample as a way to see if we can either prevent future crimes or to help solve some cold cases that might already be out there on the books.
It's important to realize that we've always taken DNA for, you know, since 2007, taken DNA upon conviction in Colorado, and that has always included misdemeanors. I think that when people say, oh, well, that's always just felonies. No, it has always included sex offenses, convictions that are misdemeanors. So what we're trying to do is expand that list of misdemeanors upon conviction. Like Michael says, you know, people that abuse people in domestic violence scenarios, they abuse strangers, they abuse kids, they abuse animals, they abuse a lot of people. And they are the type of people that should be in the DNA database. We take a lot of our data from New York. New York passed an all misdemeanor bill upon conviction in 2012. And since they passed that law, they have gotten over 1,800 burglars they've identified, but I think more importantly, over 1,200 rapists and over 270 murderers. They've gotten hits to those unsolved cases because these people got convicted of misdemeanors and then they got into the DNA database. So it's really a matter of just makes sense to take that group, that limited number of misdemeanors that we're talking about, and have those people submit their DNA upon conviction. It's not upon arrest, it's upon conviction.
So you've tried to pass this before, right? What's the resistance?
I think the resistance has been that there are some people who have some fear about the security of the DNA, or will other people have access to my private information. And the key is that if you visit one of the premier forensic labs in the country here is the one that Mitch has helped build with the Denver PD's office. And what you have are two totally separate databases. You have a DNA sample that is kept and held, and then that only translates into a number. There's never an identity that is attached to that. And there's a separate FBI or criminal database that would have to link that number to an identity. So there's never a chance that someone's DNA gets released and there's somehow a Ed Snowden challenge around people's private DNA. So I think there are some civil libertarians who see that as just a ideological issue. I think for me, it's a much more practical issue. You know, we've had in my district alone several examples. William Costello was a very high profile one. Someone who has committed a violent sexual assault was arrested and brought in on a misdemeanor. If they had taken a sample of his DNA, they would have known he was the perpetrator of this violent sex assault. We didn't, released him back out onto the street, and he went on to rape two more people. Same with true of Isaiah Hunter, who had a solicitation charge for trying to pick up a prostitute, and then went on to violently rape three different women in my district over the course of several years before we found him. I think it's in all of our interest to stop those folks from being able to pile up more and more victims while we're waiting. And so we think there's a targeted population of folks, again, that are really, these are really folks that are abusing their spouses, that are, that are John's trying to pick up prostitutes, and that are child abuse perpetrators. And these are all crimes that we know have potential likelihood to lead to more serious violent crimes. And would help us solve some of these cases and stop more violent crimes before they happened.
You know, actually, Tamara, we got a much broader list of misdemeanors, all class one misdemeanors, through the House, not last year, the year before, 3 years ago. That came out of the House. And then because they were in the middle, and I think Senator Johnston has hit on it, it was one of those years where they were trying to do all of that gun legislation. Mm-hmm. We got to the point where we got up and we had actually John Morris, who was the head at the Senate at the time, was our sponsor, we didn't go any further with it. We didn't take it into the Senate. He just didn't feel that it was right, and it kind of just died there. Michael was a co-sponsor on the thing, and we talked about it, and it wasn't the right time, but a much more expansive list. And what we've done because of the legislature and the way that it works is we've really honed this list down to just a number, and we're talking about eight different crimes here. Eight, nine different crimes depending on how you count it. But it's third degree assault, which, you know, is somebody that is hitting their wives or maybe a child. It's child abuse. It's the kind of crimes that he's talking about that really should be there, and we should be taking DNA because that will then give us those answers. And we've got the good data that shows that it's those kinds of crimes that then connect these guys to these violent unsolved crimes that sit in our database with victims that are waiting for answers. The other thing this does is that it helps us exonerate innocent people. It helps us take that good suspect that the DNA doesn't match, well, you check the database, you know they're there because they got a misdemeanor conviction, doesn't match, they're not a good suspect anymore. You don't even need to contact them. You know that from working the case, from using the database. So that database not only helps us hold accountable perpetrators of serious crimes, but it also exonerates innocent people, and the police never even come knock on their door. And it's extremely important. There, it's interesting, though, one of the attacks is this idea that somebody in the state lab will start doing all kinds of other testing with this DNA. And I think it's interesting to note that the lab can only do one kind of test. They can only use a certain kind of kit to do that. And the equipment's all paid for by the legislature. So if the state lab decides to start doing all kinds of other DNA testing, this mystery kind of slippery slope argument that's often made, the legislature has to know about it because they got to pay for it.
Right.
And so the very legislators that vote against it because of that concern are the same people that the state would have to come to say, we need all this new equipment and we're going to use these different kits because now we're going to start looking to see if somebody has cancer or, you know, all those kinds of things. It can't do it without the legislature saying yes. So, you know, it's interesting. It's a circular argument, and sometimes there's a lot of scare tactics involved in this. But we try to wade through that with good data, with cases that show that it would make a difference, studying it, bringing all those things together, and making our pitch then to the legislature. It takes years to get these bills through.
Yeah, I know. So we've got lots more to talk about on this issue and other things. Stick with us because we're talking to Colorado State Senator Michael Johnston. This is Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. We'll be right back.
Life is made of moments. Family. A drunk driver could take it all away. Keep your family safe on the road, because after all, nothing is more beautiful. Mothers Against Drunk Driving. Keep your family safe.
Welcome back to Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. This is the portion of the show where we talk about a legal term. And today's legal term is recidivism. Recidivism is the return to criminal behavior by the same offender. It refers to a person's relapse into the criminal behavior. So, Mitch, I guess it's sort of just somebody coming back time and time again.
Yeah, and it's really a way of you may have a program, for instance, like our drug court program or our juvenile diversion program, and you want to know if you're successful or not. One of the scales that we use is, are the people that we treat or are the people that are in your program, are they going back to crime? Are they committing crime? Are they recidivism? And so they go back to recidivism is really a way of measuring a degree of success. So, for instance, our juvenile diversion program has an extremely low recidivism rate. Those kids don't get back in trouble. They don't get back in trouble within a year, within 2 years, within 5 years. And you can measure that over the course of even somebody's lifetime. Did they go back to crime? What kind of crime did they commit? All those kinds of things. So it's really, it's almost like we talked about drug addicts, you know, getting back to using again, that type of thing. Well, this is somebody that has committed a crime and then goes back to committing crime. And what happened in between? Did you jail them? Did you treat them? Did you do something to try to prevent that? And did that work or not?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, just before the break, we were talking with Senator Mike Johnston. Again, welcome to the show.
Thanks.
We were talking about using DNA swabs for misdemeanors. Talk a little bit more about how that might actually be a good thing for those who are innocent in a crime.
Yeah, you know, Mitch mentioned this, and in some of the other states that have passed this legislation, the Innocence Project has been one of the chief proponents. And the Innocence Project, for folks who don't know, is a nonprofit organization that goes around trying to exonerate or get released people who have been wrongfully convicted and are in jail on bad information. And what they've found and we found is if you look at the largest share of folks who are wrongfully convicted, they're known people who are convicted on bad eyewitness accounts, right? And those eyewitness accounts tend to over-identify particularly people of color. So it's a lot of African Americans and Latinos who someone said, oh, I saw someone dark, you know, across the street under the light. And then it's not until 10 years later when you get a DNA hit on the actual perpetrator who might be living free in Florida or on a charge in another state that you actually find that this person was wrongfully convicted. And so I have both sides of this in my district. I have folks who are potentially wrongfully convicted, and we have folks who are victims who are waiting for justice on that side. So I just think Mitch's point is really important that this also can be a really key force for making sure that we don't have people who are wrongfully convicted sitting in prison who shouldn't be there.
The way that works with the database is you have an eyewitness that says, oh, I'm sure this is the guy. I picked him out of a photo lineup. The DNA comes back and says, no, it's not that guy. It's this guy. Because the guy's in the database because of a misdemeanor conviction, that then exonerates the person that may have gotten picked and sometimes maybe even got convicted. Mm-hmm. You know, it's that identification is not right. It's the DNA that corrects that. And the fact that the real person is in the database because they got convicted on the misdemeanors we're talking about, that's the exoneration aspect of it.
We had another example of that in my district as well, high-profile stabbing where there was a gentleman who was an African-American male who was in the neighborhood who he had the shirt that had his name on it they found in the dumpster and so had already arrested him, held him, preparing to press charges until the DNA hit came back and it turned out it matched someone else who was already in Philadelphia at that point. And so absent that hit, you could have very easily wrongfully convicted someone for murder that he had nothing to do with.
You have some pretty heavy stuff on your agenda this session, along with the DNA issue, also making sure that DUIs stay as felonies. Talk a little bit more about your work and what you're doing there.
Yeah, so we worked last year after many, many years of trying. As Mitch said, these take a while sometimes to finally pass a felony DUI bill. And so we passed the first felony DUI law last year that does now elevate repeat offenders on DUIs to felony level status. And already it's had a significant impact. I don't know about what Mitch might know the stats in his jurisdiction. We've already seen around the state folks that are multiple DUI offenders who are now picking up felony charges. And well, you know, once you've had three or four DUIs, I think that they're good people who make honest mistakes and get a DUI. Once you've made two or three or four, you're now driving a 2,000-3,000 pound vehicle down the middle of a crowded street. That's a serious safety issue. And so we're pleased with the steps there. There's some focus and opportunities for treatment along the way to make sure folks avail themselves of those opportunities. But if you've done this more than three or four times, we think that's a safety issue that requires more significant consequences.
You know, we did a whole show on it, and Fran really talked and I think gave us some insight on that three-year struggle. And Michael was right there pushing for it, and the families that had lost loved ones to multiple DUI offenders. You know, to date, we have about 30 of those people that we've charged in Denver. We have about six of them that we have put into a special, very, very strict treatment program. We have some others that will be headed that direction, but we give them that option. Do you want to do this? If you don't, you're going to go see Judge Egelhoff, who is handling all these cases right now. But if you do, you get in this program right away. It involves being in the county jail, in the RISE program, starting your work towards getting into an inpatient or outpatient program, and then continuing on during the course of that. And the nice thing about it is that Fran, who was our guest from MAD, mm-hmm. has been part of the talk about creating this program, making sure that those things he was looking for in the bill that Michael worked so hard to get through are there. But the idea, again, get these people sober. And if we can get them sober, then they're not going to be drinking and driving, mm-hmm. and they're not going to be that issue. So even with that many, there are is a strict criteria to get into this program. We've created this program because of dollars that were part of that bill, paying for a magistrate's salary to oversee these people in a very strict condition, and that's what we're doing. So we've taken it, we've taken the money, and we're running with it. Not everybody's getting thrown in prison. Again, we're trying to treat those that we can treat. We're giving them the type of offer that will encourage them to get treatment, but also discourage them from getting in trouble, because the downside is about 6 years in the penitentiary if they fail. So they're really at the last, this is their last stop. Mm-hmm. And the idea of keeping them out of the penitentiary has really incentivized them to get into this program.
And that was one of the hopes, frankly, of the bill, is that, you know, it takes different things for folks to come to Jesus. And sometimes if it's a felony conviction looming over your head, that's sometimes enough to get folks to choose a treatment program who otherwise would refuse to do it. And so that was exactly the hope, that you'd find creative ways for jurisdictions to say, hey, your option is a felony charge, or if you want to take very serious steps in a treatment program, we'd love to help you do that, but there has to be some real consequences attached. I think that's a good development.
So obviously you support treatment for substance abuse. Talk to me a little bit about Denver Drug Court and what your thoughts are.
You know, I've had the privilege of being at a couple Denver Drug Court graduations and never leave there with a dry eye by the time it's over. And I just think it's such an amazing, if your viewers haven't seen one, you absolutely should go watch one, because it's one of the most life-affirming things you'll see. You hear every person that graduates gets to speak, and they tell their own story about how long they were lost and how much of their life they gave away and family they lost and friends and jobs until they finally got their act together. And when they stand up on the stage and graduate and say, you know, I'm clean now, I'm sober now, I got my wife back or my kids back or my job back, it is an amazing testament to the power of government to do good things. And so I've been really moved by watching it. And when I saw it, I thought, if there's anything we can do to get more folks into this program, let's do it. And if one of those is to say, listen, for those hardest cases who refuse to do that, if we can say a choice between this and a felony, and I think those folks would be the first ones when I would talk to them to say, you know what, if I hadn't gotten into this, I would have just kept doing it. I would have kept drinking, kept driving, do whatever I was going to do until someone grabbed me by the scruff of my neck and put me into this kind of program. And so,
It was a few years ago, but it was the legislature that said, yeah, we'll start paying for, it was when Michael was first in, and I think Bill Ritter was still the governor, and we will start paying some of these positions that we were trying to keep afloat. Mm-hmm. We really were out of money. And when Bill left and said, you're going to take over, you're going to have to dismantle the drug court because you're going to have to close the door. You get to be that DA. And I said, no, we're not going to do that. And so we got some city funding, and we paid for the magistrate, and we paid for the public defender, and we paid for that. But if it hadn't been for the legislature saying, wait a minute, state pays for the public defender. So we weaned them off the money because the legislature, because of the votes and the money and finance and those kind of things, that's what's made the difference and kept the doors of the drug court open. Because now the state pays the magistrate's salary, and the state pays the public defender's salary, and gives us help when it comes to some of those treatment dollars that we need to keep the drug court going. So the fact that that partnership got reestablished, and the funding, the legislature said, yeah, this makes sense, we're going to push for this. Otherwise, I don't know where we would be today. And the drug court, I think, today is as healthy as it's ever been in its history. And it's the oldest drug court in the state, and it's one of the oldest in the country. But because of that partnership and that funding for those different positions that we didn't have the money for, we've been able to keep that program going and keep it strong.
Let's switch gears just a little bit and talk about children and violence and trauma. Talk to us about the trauma that really has a long-time impact on young people and what you hope to do and the legislature will hope to do this year.
In relation to these felony DUI issues, or
exactly,
just in general?
In relation to the DUI issues.
Sure. I mean, I think that, you know, there is no doubt that when you look at, I was a high school principal, when you look at kids who come into school with the farthest away look in their eyes, who you have the most work to do, it's kids that have seen an outsized amount of trauma. You know, and if it's because your mother was killed in a felony DUI, you know, by a drunk, 11th time drunk driver, or your sibling was next to you and got hit and killed by a drunk driver. Those are scars that little kids and grown-ups carry for their entire life. And so I think that what we've tried to do is, again, provide as much opportunity for intervention and for support. And so things like, you know, we were the first state to say, after you've gotten your second DUI, let's not wait for you to get your third. We now require you to have, by our new law, an interlock device for up to 5 years. So, you know, that means you literally couldn't drunk drive unless you stole someone else's car or unless you kidnapped someone and made them blow into a breathalyzer in your car to get the engine started. And so we've tried to really put in place as many opportunities for intervention and prevention because you want to be able to get the people to just start making better choices. But you also have to realize, you know, if someone, as I said last year, if someone walked out onto Colfax and shot a shotgun down the middle of Colfax at 12 in the afternoon, people would take that pretty seriously. Well, when you've done that 3 or 4 times, but it's with a F-250 pickup truck, a pickup truck going 60 miles an hour is going to do a lot more damage than a shotgun shell. And so that's where you have to find the balance between intervention and prevention and also public safety. And if they've blown through all of those interventions and still aren't able to get themselves into a better place, we got to either get them into a serious treatment program that's mandated by law or they got to be off the streets.
We just have about a minute. If there was one thing you would want viewers to know about what's happening in this session this year, what would that be? What's the most important thing?
I think the most important debate this year will be about how we get the resources we need to pay for key public services, like transportation needs to relieve congestion on I-25 and I-70, like K-12 funding and higher ed funding. We're going to see massive cuts to all those programs, and yet we're still going to be sending taxpayers, they won't notice, but you'll get about $11 back on a tax return this year. So we will be short of state services and yet still sending cash, sending tax refunds back to voters under the Tabor law. And I think that most of us would say I'd rather make sure my school's fully funded and my road's safe than get a $12 refund. But we have an overlapping challenge in our constitutional structure right now that makes that a requirement. And so there'll be an effort, I think, through Building a Better Colorado this year to try to fix that. I think that will consume most of the oxygen in the room this year, but I think it hopefully won't keep us from doing some good common sense bipartisan things like saying, let's have fewer rapists and murderers and domestic violence abusers out on the streets, which we hope the misdemeanor DNA bill will be a small step towards solving.
Well, we have some great people on both sides of the aisle this session, and so proud to have you serving Denver. Thanks so much for being with
us
today.
Thanks for having me. It was an honor to be
here.
Thanks,
Michael, Senator Johnston. It will be an interesting session in the coming year, so stick around and see what Senator Johnston has in store. You've been watching Dialogue Denver DA with Mitch Morrissey. I'm Tamara Banks. We'll see you next time.